बुधनदीं दीं तननरीं नागृदीं दीं तनन तदरतानि बुधनदीं दीं तननरीं नागृदीं दीं तनन तदरतानि बुधनदीं दीं तननरीं
Krishna Krishna
Mothers are funny creatures, aren't they? Especially dance moms. They will do anything to make their kid dance. Trust me, I know. I have been blessed with one myself. I grew up listening to her story and hoped that she would get a glimpse of happiness through me. My mother wanted to be a dancer, you see. But it was the 60s in Sri Lanka and her father wouldn't allow it. So she boxed up her dream and cried in the corner of her room. What else was her 11-year-old girl supposed to do? Well, until of course, enter yours truly. And then she tried to pass on the love to me. This story of a woman not being able to dance back in the day is more common than I realized. I still can't digest how South Asian society treated its dancers. How many dreams were suppressed? And even worse things happened. But isn't it everyone's God-given right to dance? This story is one of the first connections I had with Roja Kannan ma'am.
Lower limbs, and he suggested dance. So it was like a, you know, like a boon for my mother, you know, wanting to put me in dance, but with the family pressure she couldn't do it.
I completely felt it when she told me about her mother, and then I found the cycle continuing when I met Janani, Roja ma'am's daughter. I'm glad the society has evolved to accept dancers and has started to give the art and the artists the respect they deserve. Or at least I hope. Perhaps that's just my optimistic thinking. Today the challenges the artists face are very different, but the path to becoming a classical dancer is still very confusing.
தேகம் முழுமையும் காட்டாத மூடு மந்திரம் ஏனையா முகத்தை காட்டியே தேகம் முழுமையும் காட்டாத மூடு மந்திரம் ஏனையா முகத்தை காட்டியே தேகம் முழுமையும் காட்டாத மூடு மந்திரம் ஏனையா
I was initiated into the art form at the age of 5 along with my sister Meena and initially we went to the school of Srimati KJ Sarasa and Sarasa teacher thought we were too young to start training but my mother Mrs. Vijaya Venkatramanan was very keen and insistent that we started learning Bharatanatyam because she was very passionate about the art and in the 40s and 50s, she did not get an opportunity to learn the art form. So when her daughters were born, she wanted us to be initiated into the art as early as we could. So when we couldn't get trained under Srimati K.J. Sarasa, she took us to the dance school of Srimati Vaijantimala Bali, called Natyalaya, which was very close to our house. And at Natyalaya, we were immediately inducted, and we had the great good fortune of being under very illustrious teachers who were all working at Natyalaya. There we had our initial training under our first gurus, Sri Adyar K. Lakshman, Kavi Aravindakshan, and Trichur P. Ramanathan, and also Sri Madhuri Krishna Iyengar and Sri Sethu Raman. They were all part of the academy at Natyalaya. So we began in this atmosphere with such greats, and under the watchful eyes of Srimati Vaijantimala's grandmom, Yadaguri Devi, because Vaijanti Akka was already a superstar in the movies at that time, and we used to just get glimpses of her when she breezed in and breezed out of the house. And this is where our training began, and we learned at Natyalaya for almost 3 to 4 years. Almost every day we had classes, and after that the class was closed down due to Vaijanti Akka's commitments in the Bombay film industry. So she closed down the class and shifted bag and baggage to Bombay. So then we were left without a teacher because the class was closed down. So the teachers who were working at Natyalaya individually started classes. So Adyar Lakshman sir went to Adyar, because of which he was known as Adyar Lakshman. And Kavi Aravindakshan started a class closer to my home in Annamalaipuram, Bharatiya Kala Bhavanam. So we continued our training under Kavi Aravindakshan at Bharatiya Kala Bhavanam. And in 1972, we performed our Arangetram. I was 12 years old and my sister was 10 years old. It was in that R.R. Sabha, Rasikaranjani Sabha in Mylapur. And this was how we started our formal performances. But much before our Arangetram, we had already done in our school annual day, and in the school that we studied, Bonsakers Convent in Mylapur, Santom, Mylapur, we were called the dancing girls, because for every thing that happened in school, there was a dance and we had to be dancing. In fact, we were more practicing for dance and in the dance room in school than in the classrooms. So that was what, even now when I get in touch with my old schoolmates, oh, you were the one who kept dancing. That is what they talk, you know. So this is how my initiation and initial years in dancing started. My mother was so passionate about dance that almost every day we were watching somebody performing. At that time in Madras, it was called Madras at that time, there were performances almost every other day, and the sabhas, it was all almost free most of the time. I mean, even if they charged, it was from 5 rupees or 10 rupees. So my mother made it a point to take us to all these dance kacheris, and we used to buy the minimum ticket, 5 or 10, and then we used to sit at the back of the auditorium, and by the time the dancer came to the tilana, we will be in the first row. So for every item, we will move two rows and come in the front. You know, and we used to watch in rapt attention. Although most of it we didn't understand at that time. You know, we were about, 8, 10, 12. You know, we never understood what was happening mostly. But something attracted us to that. So that was what, we have to thank our mother for this, because she kept it going for us. Because I come from a musical family, musical background, in the sense my grandfather from my paternal side is a great musician, Palakkad Ram Bhagavathar. He was a practicing Carnatic musician and at the top in the 1930s and 40s. And so the family was more for music. Family in the sense my dad's side was more that we should be more concentrating on Carnatic vocal music rather than dancing. And dance, I think we were the first girls in the family to take up dance, my sister Meena and myself. So, but my mother was, so strong a character that she overcome all the comments and the hurdles that came her way from the paternal side of the family. Even my father was not too keen. But somehow or the other, she used to, keep him in good spirits and tell him that, no, they're doing, and we were good at studies too. So he had no reason to complain, We were sort of all-rounders, so we could manage both. We managed our time very well. So, it was all strictly laid down by my mom. By the time we came back from school, and we had to have tiffin at that time. So we had tiffin, our milk was ready, our water bottles were ready, change into our dance class dress, and leave the house. So maybe 2 hours of class, and then we came back, had our bath, and we had to do homework. And there was no television, we didn't listen to the radio at that time and all. So, finish our homework, and by 8, 9, we were all done and we were in bed. So, that sort of a routine we could manage because of my mother, constantly monitoring us and all that. And I remember this very interesting, funny incident. In Bharatiya Kala Bhavanam, after we left Natyalaya, when we went with Arvind Akshan sir, we had classes on 3 days a week, Monday, Wednesday, Friday, and we used to dance for 2 hours, 2.5 hours. There were no limitations. But then it so happened that on Tuesdays and Thursdays, we didn't have anything to do, Tuesday, Thursday, Saturday. So my mom said, why are you sitting at home? Why don't you go to the dance class today also? We told her, no, we don't have class today. She said, why not? We are giving him fees, no? Go and dance every day and come, she said. My sister, so when we went to class on a Tuesday, Arvind and master came and said, "Inni konga class illiye, why have you come today?" My sister promptly said, "You know what my mom said, since we are giving fees to you, that we better come to class every day and practice." And he was like, "Oh, neenga enakku fees kudukuringala, adanalla neenga thenum varuvingala class ku." He was so close to my family, After the class was over, he had a Lambretta scooter. So he took the scooter, he said, come on, get in. So we all piggybacked on the scooter, he brought us home. Then he came home and said, Mommy, I want to ask you something. Neenga enakku fees kudukuralame, adnala thenum varuvaala kuzhandhai class ku. My mom turned red, So that was a sort of the bond that we had with the teachers. My sister used to go and sit on his lap. Sometimes complain and kakal valikirda, I cannot dance. That was how we learnt. Although the situation is such that there were performances, music, dance, drama, almost every other day there was something happening, and we had audiences for everything. People had time to come and watch. People had time to come and immerse themselves in something cultural. Mainly because there were less distractions at that time, I feel. I think the worst happened in the 70s when the television came. That is the worst, that is the biggest blow to the arts has come from the television. I would say, especially in India and especially in Chennai, when the television came, and that just took over everybody's time. Nobody, people even have stopped reading the newspaper. They don't have time for even that. Where is the question of coming out of the house and coming for a performance? So that's the worst that has happened. So because of that, dwindling audiences, it's pathetic, literally pathetic when you come during the season. The Chennai December Music and Dance Festival is supposed to be one of the best in the whole world, and nowhere in the world do so many performances happen in a single day. And all that is very nice to hear, but the reality of the whole thing is, which many people don't report, is where is the audience for especially dance? I'm talking from the point of view of Bharatanatyam. The kacheris, the music kacheris are on a high now. They're on a high. They are just overflowing audiences for music kacheris. We don't know why that is happening. There are young audiences, they are senior citizens, they are middle-aged people sitting in the kacheris and listening, and they have somehow managed to save themselves. But unfortunately, Bharatanatyam or any classical form, if it is presented during the season, very, very limited audience. Very limited audience. And most of the time, the members of the particular sabha which is presenting the artist, the members are not present. They are ready to go for the kacheri. The members fight for tickets to go for the music kacheris, but why don't they come for dance? Where is the problem? We have to go to the root of the problem and find why has it suddenly changed? I remember dancing in Krishnagana Sabha, Brahmagana Sabha in the late 70s, in the early 80s, to full houses. We did not have to even think about the audience, whether somebody will come or whether somebody will not come, whether we will get covered in the paper. It all happened automatically at that time. You know, we had a dream time when we were performing and we were in our teen and early 20s and all. But then suddenly, why has this changed? 70s, when the television started and they started beaming movies and they started Chitrahar and Oliyum Oliyum, you know, where they were giving movie songs, that became more popular. So people did not have the patience to sit and watch a margam. So the time slots became less. What we used to be 2 or 2.5 hours of program became 1 hour 15 minutes. 1 hour, 45 minutes. What can a dancer do in that? You know, by the time your body gets warmed up, it's 15 minutes. And then you have to immediately jump into the varna. You know, what a lot of mental preparedness, the physical preparedness, the item demands, all that has gone for a six. From the minute go, you have to start running on stage. You know, very unfortunate. So this is something that we are trying to tackle from all areas. You know, how are we going to get back those audiences, get back those rasikas who were so passionate in watching Bharatanatyam performances? So as a generation, I think my generation escaped a little bit, but the next generation is the most affected in this. My students, they perform one or two kacheris a year, and they are scared whether their own relatives and friends will come. You know, oh, I just saw you last year. This is a response they get from their own people. So what is the motivation for the child to continue in the art form now? First advice I would give to the youngsters who have come to learn the art form is be sincere and committed to whatever you are doing. And if you do something, it needs a lot of hard work, and to reach a certain level, it needs years of sustenance. You should have the surviving power, you know, and you should have confidence in yourself that you can deliver it. Once you don't have that, then it is very difficult for any guru to even bring you up to any level. So the first thing is hard work, sincere commitment, and truthfulness to whatever you're doing. It will take a long time for you to reach any level. Any level. It is not easy. The road to success is not easy at all. It takes decades. It's taken me 5 decades to reach where I am. 5 decades. And 5 decades of quiet, committed, sincere work. And true to my gurus. Have utmost confidence in your gurus. Okay, first of all, the good fortune of yours will come when you choose the right guru. Okay, you should have lot of good fortune to even choose the right guru, go to the right guru. And once you go to the right guru, have utmost faith and confidence in them that they know how to take you, how to lead you. What is the meaning of a guru? The one who takes away ignorance. So you be confident in that. Be true to the guru and be committed to the guru. And it will take a long time for you to reach any level. And this generation, I sympathize with them. Really sympathize with them, because there is too much of competition, too much for them. So to prove themselves in this sort of an atmosphere is a Herculean task for them. Is a Herculean task. They have to be constantly at it, constantly at it. If they are out of the scene for one season, then you're written off. These are sort of questions come. It's true for us also. It's true for us too. Even after 5 decades of experience in the field, even now there is not many platforms where they call me and ask me to perform. There are platforms where I have to go and ask them, sir, can you give me an opportunity? It doesn't stop there. You just submit your application, your biodata, your photo. Then you have to do the following up. Keep calling them and asking them, sir, nyabam iruka na application poten indha varsham irukuma chance. And every time you give an application, they say it's too late for this year, already we have closed the application. So how does one break this and get into that? You know, these are the challenges the youngsters are facing. And which is the right route to stardom? That's another thing. Now, I have been dancing in one particular way, but I have not gone anywhere. I have not reached any level. But this other dancer is dancing in some other way, and she's already a star. So should I also start dancing like her? Or should I still keep dancing the way my guru has taught me? These are all the questions I face every day in class. In fact, I've had the same question posed to my guru when I came back to dancing after a hiatus of 13 years. I was dancing till about the early 80s, and then for 13 years with family commitments and my children, I was not actively performing. But when I came back to the scene had completely changed. Nobody was dancing the way I used to dance. There were new order was coming, there were new korvais which were going on and on and on, and people were running all over the place on the stage. I was like, sir, what is this? இப்படி தான் இப்ப நம்ம டான்ஸ் பண்ணணுமா அப்படின்னு. He said, nonsense. அவங்க ஏதோ பண்ணிட்டு போட்டோம், நம்ம என்ன பண்ணிட்டு இருந்தோமோ அதுதான் பண்ணணும். Then he showed me this. அது ஒரு வட்டம், அது ஒரு சர்க்கிள், அது அங்கேருந்து திருப்பி கீழே வரும், திருப்பியும் அங்கே போகும். நம்ம அந்த டைமுக்கு வெயிட் பண்ணணும். We have to wait for the right time when you will get the break. This is what he told me. நீ எப்படி ஆடின்னு இருக்கியோ அப்படி தான் ஆடு, அப்படி தான் நானும் சொல்லித்தருவேன், அதுதான் நீ ஆடணும். உனக்கு அதில் நம்பிக்கை இருக்கு இல்லையா, நீ அதை ஆடு. This is what he told me. That is when I slowly started, you know, gaining confidence, because I had lost it totally. What is happening? I've spent the better part of my life in this art, and then now it's not even accepting me as an artist. What do I do? So these sort of frustrations are there for many, many youngsters. Fortunately or not, unfortunately, the system has become like that. But you have to go with the times. You have to change with the times. You cannot avoid the change. Change is the only constant thing that is here. So you try to mold yourself with that change, but stick to your guns, stick to your commitments, stick to your roots, and don't get carried away by popularity. That is another thing. Nobody can become instantly popular. If you become instantly popular, then you will also lose the popularity instantly. Remember that. That is what is going to last you long is what you gain through years and years of hard work and commitment. So nobody can be an instant star, you know. And then they'll be forgotten immediately. After 2 seasons, you won't see them because they would have burnt out. They would have reached a saturation point, you know. And it's not worth it. The art form doesn't ask you to do all this. I hear of youngsters not eating, not drinking, starving when they have a performance, surviving on performance-enhancing substitutes, you know, taking painkillers, shots before a performance. What for? What is going to happen to your health 10 years hence? Think of all that. If somebody like Radha aunty or Chandru sir have survived till late 80s, or even Vaijanti Mala at 84 or 85, who is able to do a full margam, is it because of performing enhancing substitutes or going without food on the day of your performance, or starving yourself so that you reach that zero size? Not necessary, not necessary at all. It is not a prerequisite for our classical art form. It may be for some other classical dance styles that you need to have that particular size, but nobody has, nowhere is it prescribed that you have to be a certain size to be a certain, to be a dancer. There are so many examples of wonderful artists, you know, who have not fitted into any of these measurements. So leave out all that. So this is what youngsters are all, you know, bombarding me with questions like these. So it takes a long time for them to understand this, but finally some of them survive. I would say 1% survive, the rest of them just give up and go. So the, out of that 1% survival rate is what we see, you know, these days. All the rest have just given up halfway through and gone any which way they want to. So this is what the youngsters need to keep in mind when they, you know, they're all passionate about it. They're all very, very, you know, sure of what they want. But do they even invest that what they should into that is what the question is. So half-baked knowledge, half-baked understanding, half-baked learning is not going to take you anywhere. One question from a known, a very senior teacher or a dancer to you, and you can see, you know, that he is not ready at all. You know, he just learned something for the sake of that performance and performed it and gone. So that has to stop. See, that I do now at my age, you know, at my level, I do now. I go and see the secretaries, I tell them, sir, in the Roman rendu varsham aachu sir unga sabala adi inda varsham chance irukuma. I go and ask them, you push yourself. You know, I've seen youngsters coming and sitting outside the sabha office 3 times, 4 times within a month, you know. Enna kanna, why are you sitting here? No, auntie, I've given the application form. I just came to see the secretary. Good. You know, you have to do your publicity. You have to do it. And you have to look for those platforms where, you know, get to be featured, but there is no return from it, but you yet get featured, you get your name. There are 2-3 people who will spread the word around. By word of mouth, you get that publicity. Oh, avala, definitely and the program nalla standard irukum. You know, those sort of opportunities, you keep going, you keep pushing for yourself for that. Get it, keep doing it. That has to be done. That PR has to be done. Without the PR, you are not able, you're not going to survive. You will perish. So PR is a very essential part of the art now, as against what it was in the 70s and 60s and 50s, you know. So you do that. Doesn't matter. You do that. But you do it and then you also deliver good stuff after that. After all this, and then you go and do a shoddy job of your performance, then it reflects badly. That's a thing. You know, the sabha secretaries openly say, "Vittu pohaduma, engalukku vandu kattupadi aagadhu. We are not able to make ends meet if we have a dance performance. But when we have a music performance, people don't mind buying tickets, even 500,000, and come and enjoy. Even though the same singer will be singing in several sabhas, people, you know, chase him from sabha to sabha. Chase him or her from sabha to sabha. But why doesn't it happen to dance? Very few, you can count in one hand the number of artists, Bharatanatyam artists who command that audience now. Where have we gone wrong is what I am trying to analyze. Where is the mistake? you know, of course I agree there's too much of supply, too much of supply. And another thing is what I feel is one, the first step to improve this is every dancer should agree or accept to perform only once or maximum twice in a season. She cannot be dancing in every sabha because the audience is repeated. She doesn't get a new set of audience in a different sabha. So you give that chance to somebody who doesn't have a chance to perform. You know, why do you want to dance 17 days in December or 20 days in December? Take one or two performances. Take one in Mylapore, take one in Tinagar, take one out of the in North Madras or somewhere. So that you distribute your opportunity to somebody who is not performed, who is waiting to perform, who is good, who has a standard and who wants to perform. So this way you get more more artists on stage, the audience get more variety to watch, and you also ensure the quality of performances. That is where at Abhay we want to work in collaboration with the sabhas. You know, we have to tell them, please route your performances through us, route your slots through us. We will tell you which dancer deserves to be featured, which dancer is still not yet ready, who needs to get trained more. So when you give a performance at a professional level, at that level you cannot go wrong. So the audiences are not disappointed that way. Why has the disappointment come? Because lackluster, below standard, zero quality performances without any training, just because you have the push and the pull and the money to reach that sabha, you know, you find all sorts of ways to go and get your slots. But then to what end? You pay for the slot and get your slot this year. Does the sabha secretary call you again next year and say, come on, I will give you a slot this year? No need to pay because you paid me last year. No, you again pay this year for the slot. So like this, if you keep paying and getting, you're only concentrating on that one particular performance, how to corner that performance, how to catch hold of that performance. But on the contrary, in your practice, in your training, are you making any effort to invest in that? Are you seeking any improvement in the way you're getting trained? Are you going to be better than what you did last year? No dancer has got the time to think of all that. She's only doing her PR with the secretaries and not training. So how will the performance be good enough for the audience to watch? So this is a sort of a huge, you know, demon that's standing in front of us. And we are at the crossroads. We have to consciously make a decision. Now, whether it's the number of performances you do in a season, which is important, or whether it is that one performance for which you work 6 months, 8 months through the year, and give the brilliant of performances and get a good name. So that is what the youngsters of this generation have to consciously think and work towards. Otherwise, it's going to take a long, long time to get back our audiences. We have started outreach programs at Abhay. We are going to schools, corporation schools, not the HEP schools in the urban areas. We're going to schools where students from the downtrodden communities come, giving them initiation into the art form, telling them this is what is real Bharatanatyam. Don't get carried away by what you see in the movies, in the television. You can also learn. It is not restricted to just one class of the society. It is open to all. So we are trying to get our audiences right from the grassroots level. We have to start tapping them, because if you catch somebody who's in the 5th grade or 6th grade, maybe 10 years later, you might have one Rasika in the audience, you know. So this is what we are trying to do. Like what Speak Make is a all India organization which does that. At Abhay, although we are all India as far as our members are concerned, this outreach initiative that we have started in a small way this year with 5 schools in our fold. So we are trying to get the children educated about the art form and do that. conferences, many speakers have spoken about this. Dwindling audiences for dance performances. What is the solution? Where? And, but some action has to be taken. So as an association of artists, the only one in the whole world for Bharatanatyam artists is what Abhay is. You know, and the vision of that man in 1987, Sri Pakirisamy Pillai, you know, what a vision he had to bring the artists together at a time when, you know, each one was in one dhruvam, like, you know. And that has finally, you know, seen some light now. You know, we have around 3,000 members now from all over the world at Abhay, and we really have to make it go, make it work. Just go online and register. We have a website. Yeah, www.abhai.org.in. Abhai.org.in. Go online. The whole thing is there, and registration is online. You can transfer money online. We have made it very technical savvy, and you can access it on your Android, you can access it on your iPhone, on your laptop, iPad, wherever, you know, so that it reaches, because the next gen is a mobile generation, you know, so we have to also cater to their, unlike our predecessors who were all not even on email, you know, it was all handwritten letters that were circulated. It was, so from that age, we have now come to broadcast on WhatsApp groups, you know, anything that we have to just put one message and it goes to about 600 members. So it is that level that we have reached now. So the reach is more, the visibility is more, and the responsibility is more because of this. What does Abhay do for us? What is Abhay going to do for us? You know, those questions keep cropping every day, every day. So we also have a responsibility on us, and we are answerable to the community now. We have reached that level.
Nagdim dim tanana tadara tani udana dim dim